Warm welcome for you guys. Thanks for joining. And this is Digiton from Chalkquiz. Actually, we got so many participants from all over the India, from north to south. Can other participants mute yourself so that whatever I speak, you guys can hear me? Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much for joining, guys. Once again, a good evening for you all. This is Digiton from Chalkquiz, and Ramya, can you make me disable to share my screens?
Yes, yes, sir. Once again. Take number.
Yeah, cool. So, can you guys able to see me?
Yes, Bharat.
Yeah. So, hi, I'm Bharat. I'm an event organizer from Chalkquiz, and I'm a freelance UX UI designer. So, yeah, I think you guys have heard that Digiton going to help up in this following days. For past 1 month, we have been circulating our Digiton throughout our social medias. And once again, I want to thank our community partner. Design lead Francis and Udayalingam from Buff Institutes. Thank you guys for being partnering with us. And yeah, this is a digital design challenge for budding designers. So I want to tell something about our Chalkquiz. So Chalkquiz is actually a non-profit organization. We use a design as a tool to identify and solve the social problems. Actually, we used to address the social problems which surround us. So, and we used to solve that social problem with our chalk crew and from volunteers also. Our primary motto is to bring design education to an academy syllabus for all schools and colleges, and also want to spread design.
So we have been motto is to spread design across. Across all genre of people. So, and especially we focus on spreading design education in school. So we actually want to bring up this kind of design education for each and every school, bring it as a part of the syllabus itself. So that is our by and large vision. And it's been a year since we started Chalkquiz, and we have participated in a lot of such events and conducted many events for schools. I hope all of you will be excited to know what is there in this Digiton that we have been seeing. So it's a 1 week long program for all the budding designers. So I hope that all the participants that we have today, you have some knowledge in design. So either we have people from graphic design and people who are trying to transition from graphic to UX, and those who already know about UX and UI design. So what we'll be doing in this 1 week long design challenge is, so 2 days it will be, so today we are going to see about an introduction to the UX process, and tomorrow, the day two, you'll get a hands-on experience on how to use Figma. So Figma is a famous design tool used in this for designing screens and for all the UI purposes. And after that, from day 3 to day 6.
After this, you guys will be assigned with a design challenge. Few guys have participated as a team, and few guys have participated as individuals. But anyway, we will make you as a team. So by tomorrow night, Sunday night, you guys will be send some design challenge to your mail ID. So kindly check that, and also we will assign you a few groups with you. We will assign you a group, and also we'll assign some mentors, external mentors with you. For each team, we will assign one as expert mentors. So from day 3 to day 6, it means from 12th October, the exact design challenge will be started. And you guys can work according to your convenience with your team members there won't be any workshop, but you guys have to work with among yourself. You guys have to solve the problems which we are going to send you. And if you have any doubt in between, or if you have anything to come up, or anything you guys wanted, you can ask your expert mentors, which we have assigned you. So up to 15th October, you guys are going to work for a design challenge. And day 7, 16th October, Friday, before 9 p.m., you guys have to submit the design challenge, whichever we have sent you. Before 9 o'clock, you guys have to submit that. And day 8 is like, you know, Saturday, 17th October, Saturday, 3 p.m., we're going to announce the top 8 finalist team. So far, we have got 22, 23 teams, I think. So far, 90 participants are there. So we will finalize the top 8 among them. And day 9, 18th October, Sunday, 6 p.m. to 7:30 p.m., the finalized 8 teams will be presenting their work to the juries. So you guys, I have to present your presentations to the juries. They will evaluate and they will finalize the winners and runner-ups, and they will announce on day 10. So day 10, 6 to 7:30, it's totally a finale day. So on that day, 20th October, Tuesday, we have to join as now how we are joined. So on that same day, Tuesday, we will announcing the winners and runners. Not only that, on that final day, we have fun activities and also we have expert talk. This expert talk will be totally depend on the design stuff and their journey from expert. So that will be totally useful for you guys. I hope this design challenge will make you more experience and more hands-on experiences. I hope Abhijit has told you what all the steps you will gain from this designathon. So you will be getting this event. You will have your own portfolio, so you can use that for for your resume or for searching a job. And one more thing, you guys will the winners will get interns from Chalkpiece, and not only interns. We will give you that rewards and awards, and all the participants will get a professional certificate from Chalkpiece. This will enhance your portfolio, guys. Really, I'm telling. And this event is useful for you to learn UX, UI, and also Figma, and try to be connected with every day. So if you have any doubt, you guys can contact me at any time. I think everyone have my number. I'm Bharat. So thank you guys. From now, immediately from now onwards, Abhijit and Anusha will take over the UX research process. Thank you guys, and thank you the partners.
Yeah, so welcome you all. I'm Ramya from Chalkpiece. I'm the president of Chalkpiece. Yeah, once again, welcome you all for this wonderful event. Definitely, as Bharat told, you will get a lot of hands-on experience on all those things. And also, we are thanks to our partners, Buffy Institution of Design, as well as design-led community people, for organizing all those events and apart from all these things. Yeah. So, Abhijit, are you ready for this?
Yeah. Thank you, Ramya.
Okay. Yeah. So, and Abhijit and Anusha will start presenting about introduction to UX. Yes, Abhijit.
Yeah. Hi, guys. So, a very good evening to everyone, and thanks for joining us on this Wednesday Saturday evening. So, as we promised, the first day, so we are going to see about the UX part of the design. So, let's dive into it. Okay. So, yeah, since I saw that there are a lot of designers who have registered for this. So I just want to make a quick introduction about what is design. So as how the popular people, the well-known people, Steve Jobs and Don Norman have quoted it. So design is something that, so what Steve Jobs, this quote was actually delivered when he was launching iPod. So the thing is, design is not just about how things look, the visual part of it, but it's also about how it works and the value it imparts. And Don Norman, so I just want to give a quick introduction about Don Norman. So the Don Norman is the person who coined the term user experience. And he has written a wonderful book, which all of you can go through. It's called The Design of Everyday Things. And there he says, so we are seeing a lot of designs around us, but only the bad designs are the ones which attract us, or like it will catch our attention, and all the good designs will go unnoticed. But so to bring about this experience of having a smooth a flow of design, so this is where he came up with user experience design. So let's see what it is actually. So the user experience design focuses on the interaction between humans and the product. So let's take an example of a bottle. So a bottle, the way you open a bottle, so that is an interaction. So you're interacting with the bottle lid. Same ways as the product, like initially, if we take say 40 or 50 years back, we didn't have all these devices, gadgets. We had physical products. So the interaction between those, say radio, all that was very important. And now as gadgets have improved, and now we have like completely moved on to the industry 4.0, and everything is on apps, laptops and all that. So the way you interact with that has to be taken care. So a good design, so if you want to have an elite user experience, it's dependent on multiple aspects. So there is psychology coming into picture, the business needs, the market research, and of course the technology. So as technology progresses, we will be able to provide much better user experience for our users. And on bottom we can see this is the user experience cycle. So today we'll be concentrating on the research and discovery part of it. So when talking about UX, so why do we need UX? So the ultimate goal of UX is to deliver value to its user. So how it is done is by following these core principles. So whenever we design a product, we have to keep these things in mind. So the first thing is, it should be useful. Just having a product for the sense, for just having it doesn't make sense. So it has to be of certain use. Say a website, or let's take Amazon. So Amazon, the primary motive of Amazon is to make it accessible for the people to buy things from a comfort of their home. Next one is usable. So any product that you make, it should be easy for the user to use it. If you don't take care of these things, the usability part of it, then there's no use in building the product. Then next one is, it should be findable. So if you want to design a product such that it solves a purpose, so you should show them a way how they can achieve their goal. Then it should be credible. So credibility is something about trust. Hello?
Yeah, Abhijit, we can hear you. Go ahead.
Okay. Okay, thank you. So yeah, the products that you are using must also be trustful. So for example, you are making a payment, or you are giving your email ID for a letter subscription. So that time you have to, it's better to mention that you won't be using that email ID for spamming them. So that creates some sort of trust for the user. And it should be accessible. So when we talk about accessibility, so accessibility is a pretty vast topic. So when we are designing any product, so we have to take into consideration different group of people. So let's take a person who is colorblind. So he also should be able to use our product. An old person also should be able to use the product. And you can see this example very well in Windows. So where they are providing a zoom feature. So you'll have a magnifying glass. So it's mostly used by people who have a disability in seeing properly. So providing such functionalities enhances the user experience part. And then finally, it should be a desirable product. So people should accept it. So that acceptance part, mostly we get using the user feedbacks that we are getting. Now that we have seen what user experience design is, then there's something called user-centered design. So to provide a better user experience, this is something that we have to keep in mind. So whenever we are designing any product or any services, we have to keep user at center of everything. So these are the four major guiding principles of user-centered design, or commonly it is known in the industry as UCD. So the first thing is the task that the user is going to do. So that comes in the form of requirements. So that has, so we have to study about the task that they're doing. So what are the nuances of it and all that. Then we have to incorporate a fine way of collecting user feedback so that we can define the requirements better. Then we also have to, so we have collected all the feedbacks. And one major thing that like pretty much most of the product nowadays miss is involving users at every step of their design. So this is done by actively collecting feedback. So let's take an example of a website. So every time when a visitor, when a user visits the website, so we have to monitor, like what are the difficulties that they are facing? What is the task they want to do? And where are they finding the hindrances? So all that has to be evaluated. And finally, all the process is, the process never ends. So it's an iterative design. So it just keeps going in loops and loops. So there's always scope for improvement. So when we say about a user-centered design, how do we know what the user wants? So we have been talking about all that now. So this is an example of empathy. So whenever we are interviewing a user or collecting feedback from the user, we have to empathize with the user. So we have to put ourselves in their shoes and look at the world. So it's everything about how the user sees, feels, and experiences the world. So for example, if presented with a certain task, so what do they think about the task? So do they say, okay, it's difficult? For example, let's take example of crossing a road. So what they see a lot of vehicles. Then there's a traffic controller. So that's what they see. And what they think? So they think that, there's so much traffic here, so I must wait for either the light to turn red, or if there are no vehicles, I can just move on. And what they do? So thinking and doing is a complete different thing. So they can think a lot. They can think that, there's very less cars, so I'll just run. But there'll be some sort of thing that'll be stopping them to break the law. So that is what they do. And every time when we conduct the user feedback sections or user research, we have to make them in a comfortable position to observe all this. So now that we have seen about empathizing, so this is like in user research is the place where we are using the empathy. So what is the purpose of conducting a user research? So the first thing is, by conducting user research, we really come to know whether what we are making is really relevant. Does the user need that? Or are we just making it just to like solve the business need? And finally, we come to know that one day that, okay, we have built all this, but no one is using. So that is again a big loss for the business as such. And then the product that we have made, is it useful for the user? Is it easy to handle? And does it deliver some value? Then the last point is, does it like we are investing so much on user experience design. So what are the benefits out of it? What is the return of investment? To understand that also, we conduct user research. So now like I'll be talking about what are the types of research that can be conducted. Coming to the types of research that can be conducted. So let's classify it into two. So one is the quantitative part and other is the qualitative part. So quantitative part is where we send out surveys and questionnaires. So this is generally addressed to a larger group of audience. So usually how this is done is they will prepare a set of questionnaire and send it across through different channels. So there are specific sites where you can find such surveys. So there are a lot of there's actually a group out there, a community who distribute such surveys and collect the user insights. So all that will be getting the opinion of the masses. So out of that, say we have given out the survey to 200 people and we have got the response. Out of that we will be shortlisting two people and we'll be conducting in-depth sessions with them. So that is what is called as a qualitative research. So in qualitative research, we'll be sitting down with the user, or for now we are, since we are in lockdown, let's say we have a audio conferencing and we understand what their needs are. And like, do they really have a problem in using this and all that? So it's always in this order. So first they will conduct a survey and after that they'll do the qualitative research or the interview. And as a part of research, so we also have something called user testing. So this comes in the later part of a design cycle. So once you have completely built your product, you need to collect insights. So how well have you solved the problem? So is there any other scope? Or have we failed at what we are going to deliver? So all such insights come through user testing. Okay, so now that you have conducted the user research, how do you identify the problem? So that is the let's say that's the billion dollar question, solving the right problem. So once you identify majorly what is the problem you have, that is almost equivalent to solving 80% of what you're trying to build. So I would like to take one example. So like how to identify the pain point or the problem. So this is what we're going to see in this one. So this is an example of something called a user journey. So user journey is nothing but, let's say a user or a person is presented with a task. Here, I've taken an example of using Google Pay. And it's, let's say an old person, so he's 40 years of age. He wants to transfer 5,000 rupees to his colleague. So what does he do? So this is a sequential step-by-step process. So first he opens the app, unlocks the screen, then he tries to find his colleague by his name. So since he's going to transfer it for the first time, he's a little afraid, as in, because he's sending 5,000 rupees. So first he'll be sending a hi text. Then he will call up his friend and ask, hey, did you get my hi text? Then if he says, yes, I have, then again, he'll be like, okay, let's check if it really works or not. So he will start by sending out, sending 1 rupee or say 10 rupees. Then again, he will call up that person and ask, have you received the amount? If he says yes, then he will proceed to pay out the entire 5,000 rupees. Then, so he will enter the amount, then he will enter his PIN and the payment is successful. So now we have seen the user journey of a 40-year-old person who is trying to send 5,000 rupees to his friend. So if you see this part where he gets a spectacle about sending that, and he's not trusting the channel, does it really work or not? So this is a major pain point. So if you look at the Google Pay app now, so there'll be, as soon as you open up, you search a person and you're going to make the payment for first time, it will have a automatic suggestion to send hi or a 1 rupee. So that is how Google solved that problem. So the major thing lies in finding what the real problem statement is. So, okay.
Abhijit, 1 minute, 1 minute. Sorry. Before that, going to next screen, I want to do one small activity right now, because can you show me once again the screen, previous screen?
Yeah.
So I want everyone to interact right now in a chat box. So I want to know who are, how many of you guys are using this Google. Guys, can you mute it? So how many of you guys are using this Google Pay app right now? Can everyone answer in the chat box? Okay.
More specifically, Bharat, I would like to know how many of them have
actually. Yeah, I want to, next my question is that only. Oh, you use it daily. Shit, Atriya, okay. Oh, I think everyone is using this Google Pay. Okay, so how many guys have faced this pain point, this stage, sending hi first, then sending 1 rupee, then after only you guys verified, only you guys used to send the other monies. So yeah, Joshita,
yeah,
first view. I never do that, Atriya. Yeah. Because you have trust, I think, Atriya. Oh, you have used to. Okay, I just said hi.
I'll be on call when sending. Nice. Major trust issues.
Large amount of money. Yeah, definitely. Yeah, that's cool. Okay. Oh, your dad will used to do. Okay. Yeah, for new payments, unknown numbers. Okay. Have you guys misused or misly sent some money to somebody without knowing? No. Never. Okay.
So everyone is cautious.
Yeah. So I think we address that pain point, right? So that is exactly a user journey. So once we enter into app, we want to know where the pain point is exactly. So that's what Abhijit is explaining right now. I hope everyone have used this Google Pay. So this is a real-time example. So for anything you guys are coming up, we have to know, we have to address which is the pain point, real pain point. So when we are handling a bigger amount, we want to know whether the exact persons to whom we are sending, right? So that's a pain point in this app. So they handled very nice, like chatting. They came up with a hi message, chattings, hello. I think not hi, it's actually hello, right?
Hello. Yeah.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hi. So hello message. So and we can send a minimum 1 rupee amount to that to the person's concerned person. Then once they have confirmed, we can send a huge amount, right? So this is the exact pay point. I hope this will help you guys. This journey map is too much important. Yeah, Vijit, you can go ahead. Thank you guys. Thanks for your response. Keep going.
Yeah. So next up, I want a volunteer. So anyone volunteer? So what you have to do is you have to say your journey map. So first one will be your journey of buying a laptop from Amazon. So what are the things you do? So any volunteers? Okay, then Bharat, can you just...
No, actually that Bharat is not me. It's a participant.
Okay.
Hey, hi. Yeah, hi, this is Bharat.
Hey, hi, Bharat.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, Bharat. So, yeah, you can explain like what of your journey map for buying a laptop.
First I look into my budget. Then I look into all my specs.
Okay.
Specs. Before selecting the specs, I do some Google research, saying that what are the specs available and what cost. Then I filter out which is the best brand where I can buy.
Okay.
Let's say an Apple, HP, Dell, Lenovo on that. And this is the process. Then I'll see whether do I have any discounts like cashbacks or else like do I have any like do I get any extra thing if I buy online? Then I'll make a online payment.
Okay. Great. Great, Bharat. So do you also like after buying, like after you get the product, do you also give reviews for the product?
Yes. Definitely.
Yeah. So yeah. So that was the, so I think Bharat might have mentioned about 12 to 13 steps for completing his laptop purchase. So now let's take another user journey. So you want to get your dinner from Swiggy. So anyone else? Hello, any other volunteer? So you can explain the journey that you...
Yeah, I want a good interaction section, guys. Don't be silent. Anyone can come up like a Bharat. So have fun and you know, more interactive. Raise your questions and raise your answers, everything. Anyone can come up? Any volunteers? Anybody?
Yeah, Vaidhi Nathan.
Hello, is someone else talking?
Yeah, what's your name?
Vaidhi Nathan.
Yeah, Vaidhi Nathan. So yeah, you can explain like what is your journey of getting a dinner from Swiggy.
Firstly, I open the app and then look at the top things that Swiggy is showing me. Because initially they show all those the top combos or offers and all that will be showing up on the top, obviously. Yeah. So I look at that first, and if it is like if I don't want to have a entire combo, I want to go for an individual item, I'll go you know, searching for my favorite items or things that I've ordered in the past or something, depending on the mode. If I want to try out something new, I'll look at new places that I can order from. Otherwise, if I want to order something that I've already ordered, I'll click on reorder button or something like that. And then I look at the pricing, then apply my coupon code if there's any coupons or stuff. And then I place the order. Check for the address and place the order.
Okay. Great. And after you make the order, how many times do you look into your phone where the delivery boy is?
Oh, I look into it like some 10 times or something.
Great. So that's what, if you see, like in your case, you have mentioned close to 8 steps. So 8 steps, that's the elaborate 8 steps. So usually people like do it in 4 or 5. So now you can see the difference between these two platforms, Amazon and Swiggy. So in Amazon, they have kept the process a bit longer so that you can compare the product that you're buying. So you have an elaborate review section. You can compare multiple products based on the pricing and all that. And of course, in Amazon, you can buy out multiple products at a time. Whereas if you take Swiggy, you can choose only from one particular restaurant and order in a go. So yeah, that's a great thing, guys. So I think you got a gist about what a user journey is. So whenever you are designing any application or say any physical product or something, so it can comprise of multiple such user journeys. So that's it with how a user research is conducted. So next on in our coming section, tomorrow we'll be learning about how we design things. So the first part we have covered today is research and discovery. So you learned how we can use user research for coming up with the problem statement and finding the pain point of the user. And after finding the pain point, you can obviously like come up with a better solution to it. So even for coming up with solution, so what we do is we collect all the pain points after we do the user research. So there'll be multiple such, like how we saw now, the user journey of each person. Like that, we will have multiple user journeys. And out of that user journey, we will find which, at what point they are facing difficulty. How can things be made better so that they don't have to go through all that process? So that is where we come up with solution. So there also we have a method called a 5Y method. So we use that 5Y to find the root cause of the problem. So based on that, we can come up with multiple such solutions. So let's say we have 2 solutions. So has anyone observed that Facebook, I think a year back, they were actually doing a user test. So for a few people, say in Android itself, they had the navigation bar on the bottom. And for a few users, it was on top. So did any of you notice that?
Okay. So for the web version, it was on top, I guess. And on the app version, it was on the bottom.
So even for web, even for application, few people had it on bottom and few had on top. So essentially what they were doing is they were trying to find which is the best approach. So which is more usable. So that is something that we call it as a A-B testing. So they give a multiple version of the same product and let the users use it and collect that data. So it's again a data-driven decision-making. So that is a very important part of user research. So as of tomorrow, you'll be learning about how to prepare the UI screens. And after that, so once you make your design, so you validate it. So exactly how like Facebook had done it. So there are validation at 2 steps. So one is after you design your thing. So you make screens and you don't actually go into the stage of development. So before that, you will ask 4 or 5 people to come to your office and give the prototype, the design prototype of it, and ask them to use it. So based on that, we get a lot of insights. And again, so there's a high probability that we will come up with a certain problems that they are facing again, and some place where we have thought that solution, but it's not actually solving the problem. So all such things we can find out. So that is what we call as a validate and test. So after we validate, so again, that will again go for a lot of iterations. So after the entire iteration design phase is done, then we move on to building the product. So what happens here is like after, since we have already like tested out our concept and then we go to the building the product, we save a lot of money here. So let's say that we didn't do the design part, we just had an idea, just built it and sent it out. So then we'll get some feedback and there'll be again a lot of round robin. It'll be like a lot of iteration going on within the engineering team. So that is a very costly thing for a company. And so finally, when we follow this UX design process, at end of it, so we, as we said, in the user-centered design process, there is no end. It's always iteration. So we always continuously get the feedback from users and keep on improving the product. So, Dorsen, yeah, I would like to mention like what are the benefits of UX. So what is the return on investment? So one thing is it helps us get better understanding of the problem that we need to solve. So we can get the finer nuances. So what is the actual problem that we are facing and all that. So our solution can be much more specific to the user group. Then the next one is, as I mentioned before, it's a faster, much faster way of validating the concept. So even before you make the minimum viable product, so you can test the concept that you're using. So is it actually solving the problem or not? Then, so as we are able to validate it through the design, so that saves a lot of time. So time as in time taken for development. So that is a very huge, if I give a ratio of it. So let's say it takes 2 days to design something, it will take 10 days or more to build it. So we are saving that much time, and time is again equivalent to money. So that's a very, that's the biggest ROI of UX design. And then we also come to know that that we are solving the right problem for the right people. So that is one thing. And finally, the net promoter score. So what a net promoter score is, so let's say we have Book My Show. So do you remember the time when Book My Show was introduced? So prior to that, no one had booked online. But after that, like few people started booking all the movie tickets online. Then you will be, the person who has booked will be referring. So they'll be saying, hey, why are you like bothered about getting a ticket tomorrow, standing in the long queue? There's an application which is solving your problem. So the users become the promoters. So a better UX user experience will definitely give a better net promoter score. So that is it with the, let's say, the theory part of user experience and user research. So now I would like to give showcase a small case study that was made by one of our team. So we had participated in a contest conducted by institute called UMO Design. I think few of you might have heard of it. So they conducted it, and around the world, close to 230 teams participated. And this is one of the case studies that we made from Chalkface, and it was one of the finalists too. So the problem state, the initial problem statement that was given was, what are the problems that is arising due to the lockdown situation, due to the pandemic? And we have to come up with a solution to that. So we ventured out into the part of agriculture, and we started out by conducting few surveys. So we sent out a survey form to a few of the local market people, and then we had since our target group were farmers, so they didn't use technology much. So we had to meet them over call and get their inputs. So these were the few problems that we identified amongst the farmers. So this is especially I'm talking about when there was a complete lockdown. So the pandemic situation was very worse. So there was a lot of stagnation happening at their end. So the producers, they were not able to sell their product, and there was also a demand in the market. So what is that? When we tried to do the user research and find the root cause of it, so these were the major problems. So one thing was they were not allowed to travel, and all the local market was shut down, and the price had drastically reduced. So the farmers were not willing to sell out their product for such a low profit, or let's say most of them didn't even get any profit, and they had to throw it all. So it was a complete waste of their energy, time, and most of the farmers that we interviewed, they had even taken agricultural loans and all that. So they were not able to, they were not in a position to repay that also. So the process that we followed, so again, so what we discussed earlier, the human-centric design. So this is exactly what we followed. So we found to whom we are going to address the problem. Like, whose problem are we going to solve? And what is the technical feasibility of achieving that? So that is one major thing to consider. So we can come up with solution that is very much futuristic. Maybe out there in 30 years, the technology might be ready to solve it. But if you want to deliver the solution now, you can't rely on that. So having the feasibility check always very much needed. Then how viable the solution is. So, and we had to consider all these factors also. So this is by and large. The initial problem statement was what are the problems faced by the farmers. So when we narrowed it down, so we found that most of their producible, the vegetables, fruits, they were getting rotten because there was no timely transport. And the agencies were not allowed to travel also. So these are some data that we got through our research. So you can see that nearly 70% of the people, they were completely dependent on agriculture for their livelihood. And this one we conducted in a village. And again, nearly 82% of the people were doing some other job also for getting income apart from the agricultural standpoint. And most of them were sort of having a small stores or something. Yeah, so where we found the opportunity to solve the problem is, this particular situation during lockdown, we thought we have to come up with a system that will be even relevant after the lockdown is over. So kind of like a facility that connects the farmer and the vendor. So through this solution, we were giving things at an affordable rate to the end user and also reducing the loss to the farmer. So as part of our user research, so we had interviewed a person, and we found out what was his goal and what are the frustrations he was facing. Then so this is an example of one of the user persona. So like this, we had talked to multiple people and found all their pain points and zeroed it down to what has to be done. So this is the solution that we came up with. So here, the solution we proposed was addressing the farmer and the organization, that is us, and also the end user, the vendor. So essentially, like a lot of the farmers, they didn't have access to digital technology. So as I mentioned, the UX, it should be accessible. So under such a circumstance, what we thought was using a promotion program. So there can be like TV ads, radio ads, newspaper ads for letting them know that there's an organization which can help you to collect your produce agricultural output and bring it out to the market. So, and bringing vendor into the picture was again a big step, because at that point, transportation, the vendors could not transport their product. So we also had to like contact the vendors and find out their pain points as well. And the final, the end product of our this thing, and the entire journey was a mobile application where the farmers, they'll be able to raise for request to collect their product. And they can also, like how, let's say in Swiggy, we, after we place the order, we get a live tracking of where the order is. So in a similar manner, whatever they are giving, so they can track their goods. And they can also compare the what is the market price and all that. So this again helped them like reduce the loss they were having. So and we also ensured that all the payments are directly done to the farmer, so that there's no delay for them. And this in turn had a like, will have a bigger impact on the farmers as such. So yeah. So this is the value that our product had. So the farmers, they didn't have to fear about the transportation and all that. And the price fluctuation also was not much. And so they didn't have to, again, like depend on other vendors. And like say a farmer, actually, like they sell it out to multiple vendors. So there'll be some sort of auctions and all that going on. So they didn't have to worry about even that. So again, same way there was some impact for the vendors as well. So even they didn't have to worry about the transportation, and we also had a QR code verification system for making the payment and all that. So that is pretty much the case study that we have covered. So I hope it was like a informative session. Manisha, is the project live? No, it's not live yet.
Yeah, thank you. But actually, it's going to be live right now. Not right now, but maybe in the future. We are planning that to bring that project in live, guys. I hope you guys understood the case study. Wow, obviously, this narrated. It's actually a real-time problem. So what? As I said previously, Chalkquiz is used to take social designs and also a real-time problem which revolve around us. So we thought, you know, farmers are facing that really problem, not only during lockdown, also right now also they are facing. So we thought to bring them in a complete breakthrough for that problem. So this is the one of the solutions we came up with. Do you guys have any questions that, you know, the farmers use this app directly? Abhijit?
Yeah. So there are a few questions in the chat. Do the farmers use this app directly? Yeah, they can use this app directly. So one conclusion that, like, one hypothesis, let's take, that we thought was the farmers, like, since they are from like a bit of like rural India, so they might not have access to technology. So that is the hypothesis that we had in mind. But after we conducted the research, we came to know that almost the 80 to 90% of the people that we talked to, they are having a smartphone. So that is the intent of why we had the application. And again, since we were like directly communicating with farmers. So if, most of them didn't know English. So we have also provided a multi-language support also to it.
Yeah, yeah, multi-languages. Most of them don't know, Swarna. You're right. Where was this study conducted? It's conducted near our rural areas. We approached a few farmers. So yeah, got feedback from them.
Is this app going to be throughout India or somewhere else around planning to launch in Tamil Nadu?
No, yeah. Initially in Tamil Nadu.
Right now we are planning in Tamil Nadu because we want to know that feedback session, right? As okay. Previously one of the stages Abhijit said is actually a process of UX. So mm-hmm. we want to know the feedback from the farmers. So once mm-hmm. it's break that all those problems, mm-hmm. then we try to bring this to throughout the India.
Okay, and one more question from me.
Yeah, yeah, see, right.
Yeah, and from one more question from me. See, actually, I'm from a farmer family, and people great. From yeah, I'm right now I'm a designer. I'm into technology now. So what my question is, like you said, like you have conducted several interviews, but I'm worried, like since being from a farmer family, from my circle itself, there are people who doesn't know English. They do have smartphones, but they doesn't know how to access that. And do you have any training program here planned for any training for programs for them? Since when you take Tamil Nadu, we have almost 60-65. I have a survey on that. Almost 60-65% of from rural places, and they doesn't know English. They have no idea about technology. They do have smartphone. They can afford our smartphones, but they doesn't have the technology knowledge. How you guys are going to arrest that gap? You have any plan on that?
Actually, it's a good question. May I know your name?
Yeah, I'm from you. I'm Yoga from Chennai.
Oh, that's great, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, Yoga. Actually, we have planned. You're right. You're right. 60% of populations are don't know about that, how to handle this mm-hmm. smartphone. But the thing is, even they are trying to use that mm-hmm. smartphones. The thing is, we volunteers. As I said, as Abhijit mm-hmm. mentioned, we will show them. We will teach them how to use this and how to interact with that app. Abhijit, can you show that previous slide?
Yeah.
That user journey, I think. Yeah, mm-hmm. this one no solution. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we conduct the vendor members program, mm-hmm. also the farmers members program. Mm-hmm. So in that we try to educate them, mm-hmm. and we try to adapt them about this app. But this is an initial step, right? This is an initial start. So it will take some time. It will take some time to for them to adapt this this stuff. Actually, mm-hmm. here, so many, I think from farmer family, you know about that. Mm-hmm. The vendor, the farmer will use to produce something mm-hmm. in a lower price, but in while coming to the market, it's actually end up in a higher price, right? But mm-hmm. don't know what is happening in between.
Yeah.
It's actually political issues.
Yes.
I think true. you know well about it. Yeah. To break that, we can be, be in a in-between like a organization. So mm-hmm. we will break that all those things. We will straightly ask the farmers to send to the vendors. Mm-hmm. So that gap will be as a bridge, and we will make them through every nook and corner how it's going in, and so that will help the farmers to produce a more number of product, and also they will gain the more number of prices what exactly the vendors is giving out.
Okay.
But this is really a new initial step for us.
Okay.
It will take some time. It will take some time for farmers to adapt this.
Okay, that's great. That's good. You have taken initiative. But see, I have plenty of questions in here. If you are okay, I don't think this is the right time to all ask all these questions.
Yeah.
Okay.
This is actually.
Yeah, I understand that. I understand that. If you can, if you are okay, we guys can connect later on this.
Yeah, we will connect later on.
Yeah.
The thing is, here we thought to show one of the case studies. so that that will use all those participants, that how we have to take one real time problem, mm-hmm. and how we are going to execute that, and how we are going to take the process, yeah. and how we are going to bring out the solution among that.
Yeah.
So first, as Abhijit said, he just explained the what are the UX process.
Mm-hmm.
This is
mm-hmm.
the one type of UX process actually.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So he just taught that basics of the UX process, mm-hmm. and then we showcase that our case studies. And we have solving so many problems, not only this case studies, we have so mm-hmm. many real time problems actually,
okay.
with us.
Okay.
We are trying that, and we are building that not only digital platform, apart mm-hmm. from digital platform also we are addressing that social issues.
Okay, that's great. It's a nice initiative. Let's connect later than on this.
Yeah, so, sure. So I think one of the participants asked previously that, can you tell me about the Chalkbiz, what you guys are doing? Yeah, I want to tell once again that Chalkbiz is really a non-profit organization, but you can ask why you are giving a registration fees then. Yeah, this money we are going to use for the one of the child in a village rural area for their studies. So this will directly given to the students, but we won't give to them. We will adapt them, and we will make to know that whether they are really studying that one, make using of that. And one more thing, we are not only coming up with this digital problems, we are also coming up with a real time problem and real time solutions. This is the one of the case studies we are showing. That's it. I hope you guys have understood about what is it Abhijit said about the UX process and the case studies. If you guys have any doubt regarding that, what he took right now, I really want to know. Can you guys open up?
Hello. Hi. I'm Vartika. I have one question regarding the case study. I want to know. So basically, you are making the application for farmers, and is it only related to one state or one city, or does it include almost every place in India?
Yeah, as I said previously, we just plan to bring up real-time app in live for Tamil Nadu right now. Future, once it's success, we will bring that to the all over India.
Okay, no, but I wanted to ask, like, as I did one of the survey in one of my projects, so there is like a language difference almost every 10 kilometers.
Yeah, you're right.
You find at least one or the other word is different. So how are you like planning to tackle that problem? Because probably the vendor could be from somewhere else of the other corner of the village or the city, where they might speak some other language, and the farmer can be from some other place. So how are you going to tackle that? Not taking the case of the complete India, where there is a huge language difference.
Yeah, you're right. You're right.
Even north and south, if you talk of.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. We are working on that. We are working on that because, you know, this initial stage, even we are facing so many problems to bring this live. I think it will take some time. As I said previously, it will take some time because in Tamil Nadu, so far, everyone is speaking only Tamil. So we want to trial with them first. Once it succeeds, as you said, we will bring this into multi language, so that we come to know whether this is useful for all those languages from all over India. It will take some time.
Okay, and for any person who is not literate, yeah. It's not educated, but yeah, who is not literate or who cannot read or write properly, or probably a person who is visually impaired, because a lot of farmers are basically, because of heat and dust, their eyes are ruined. They cannot see properly. So what about that? Like, is it being considered or?
Yeah. So I think while designing, that is the standard, right? Our 3A standard, so where we check the color contrast of each color and the text that we're using.
Okay.
So yeah.
Have you heard about color theory now?
Yeah.
So yeah.
So you are using the contrasting altogether.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Apart from this case study, in general way, I'm just asking, have you have any doubt about this session, guys? Any of you?
Hi, this is Bharat.
Yeah, Bharat. It's me, Bharat.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. Tell me a story about the how the chalk piece started and how we are want to make a journey of this chalk piece and how this will impact for your company or this your chalk piece.
I actually, you know, thank you guys for eagerly asking, for curiously asking about this question. Once again. We have planned the session separately. By finale day, you know, on 20th October, as I said, we will tell you about the chalk piece. We will inform you what we are doing right now and what are the stuffs we are using and what are the things we are doing in chalk piece. For sure, we will tell you on finale day. Still few more days, you guys have to wait about that. Wait for that.
Hi, sir. Can the college student be a part of your team?
Sorry, I didn't get you.
Can a college student be a part of your team? The organization.
Organization.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll let you know. Keep in touch. We'll let you know. But you can part of our team by, you know, winning this digithon. Winners will surely get their interns from a chalk piece.
Okay, thank you.
Actually, we are more than 80 members in our chalk piece right now, with full-time members and volunteers. So yeah, you can be a part of a chalk piece. And do follow your mail, guys. I'm just being getting so many calls and so many messages that you didn't receive anything. We will send you the mail for everything. For tomorrow session also, we will send you mail. And reminder also, I think a few guys have not yet joined yet because of maybe some issues, I think so. Only 78 participants actually joined right now. So if your friends, I mean, who have registered, tell them, kindly ask them to check their mail. Let me know if you have any inquiries or anything regarding the sessions. And if you have any doubt about the schedules, it's there in our chalk piece webpage. And also you can follow our Insta and LinkedIn for more update. I hope you guys will enjoy the design challenge. And one more thing, I can give you one hint about design challenge, guys. The problem what we are going to give is really a real time problem, which we all facing right now. So this one only I can tell you right now. By tomorrow night, you guys come to know what the problem we are going to send you. Yeah, hello. All of your teammates will get your mail.
Actually. Hello, sir. Hello, sir.
Yeah, tell me. Who is that?
So, sir, like for the design challenge, like you will be evaluating us according to the both like the UI and UX, right?
Sorry, I didn't get you. Come again.
For the design challenge, you will be evaluating us for both UI and UX, right?
Yeah, you're right. We will evaluate both UI UX.
Okay, sir.
And you guys will come to know about the juries also. They are from big background. By tomorrow, I think we will announce the juries to you. So really work hard and come up with a real case study, guys. You know, the process. If you have any doubt in among your teams, let me know. And also you can ask your external mentor at any time. They will help you out. But the thing is, they won't give you idea about the solutions. You know, you guys have to come up with your own solution. They will give you suggestions and they will give you the inputs, how to take over everything they will give you. But the thing is, you guys have to come up with your own solution. So discuss with your team and individual guys who are registered, we will make you as a team. And once we form the team, try to interact with each members and work according to the convenient time. I hope you guys will have fun. And at the end, I'm hoping that we will get more case studies, real-time problems, real-time solutions from you guys. I'm so excited to be, you know, waiting for your case studies. And tomorrow at same time, 6 o'clock, we are going to start our UI part, and we also will teach you guys the glance of Figma. I think you guys all know about the Figma. It's actually so many industries, so many main industries are using Figma right now. So it will be more useful for you guys. No, don't miss it out. Don't miss out. I hope you'll join tomorrow. Can I use Adobe XD? It's totally depend on you guys. Which are the software you guys can use. But we are going to teach you Figma tomorrow.
Hi, Bharat. This is Kausalya.
Yeah, Kausalya. Tell me.
So, how are the teams formed? Because I remember when we were filling out the form, we've added another participant, which we wanted to be, whom we wanted to be on the team. So, on what basis the teams are divided?
Are you registered? As a, yeah, group, as a group or individual. So yeah, we are all registered as a group. We won't miss a, we won't separate you guys.
Okay.
You guys will be in the same team.
All right, thank you.
Only the individual guys who registered, they will be put upon in a particular team. Yeah, team contain how many members? Yeah, that's a good question. We are planning to 3 to 4 members right now. You guys will know that in the following days. Actually.
But I have 3 members in my team. I guess all parted from this group, I guess. I am the only person in this group right now.
Oh, they didn't join?
Not sure how. They joined, but I'm not sure where they are. They are in the group now. They are taken. They are in the part now, but I don't see they're in the participant list.
Maybe they would have missed out. Can you ask them?
No, I spoke
can
to them. They are online now. They said like they are online. They are looking in you now, and they are hearing all what we are speaking.
Then they will be a part of your team, right?
Yes, I'm not seeing them. I'm not seeing them here.
No, anyway, we have not said group right now. Don't worry.
Okay. Okay.
After this workshop, after the 2 days workshop, we will make you, mm-hmm. In a team. If you guys mm-hmm. have registered as a team, then don't worry. You guys will be as same as you registered. Only the individual mm-hmm. participants who register separately, they will, mm-hmm. We will make them to as a team, So don't worry, you guys will be same as how you guys have registered.
Okay, that's good.
And only after tomorrow, after UA session, we will assign you a design challenge, and we will assign you the external mentors for each team.
Okay.
And if you have doubt, you can ask your external mentors after that, or if you have any doubt among your team, you can ask me at any time. And I think I'm getting a call from late night. Maybe I won't be available at that time because I have so many work to do. Before you guys call, can you guys text me in WhatsApp so that I will be available? I will check it out, and I will ping you guys. Any doubt, guys? Any doubt apart from this? I see you so much silent. Yeah, who is that?
Yeah, Gajendran Bharat.
Yeah, Gajendran.
Actually, right. Most of them still they are not registered Google form.
Yeah.
Just
thank you. Google. Thank you for the instructions. But yeah, guys, I think after you guys would have some Google form, I want everyone to fill that and send it back to our Chalkpiece mail ID, because once you guys have not filled that Google form, we can't make you as a team.